Ladies and gentlemen, let me call this meeting to order. If you have not signed in on the sheet on the back table, please sign in for us so we have a record that you are here. For those of you that may have never been here, this is the Valdosta County Zoning Board of Appeals. This is the September 1 meeting, the way we operate, so you can keep up with us. I will call each case by case number and case name. Someone from staff will come to the lectern. They will give us the request as it has been presented with whatever information. Once they have presented it, there will probably be discussions or questions from board members to staff or among board members. Once we feel like we understand what has been presented, then I will ask if there are any persons here in support. If the applicant is here or someone representing the applicant is here and would like to give us additional information, please come to the lectern, give us your name and address for the record. Give us the information you would like for us to take under advisement. If there are multiple people here in support, due to the size of the crowd and time limitations, please do not come up and give us the same information two and three and four times. Once it's been presented, we have it. Once we're satisfied, we understand what is being requested and questions and then all have been asked and hopefully understood. I will then ask if there are any persons here in opposition. If there is opposition, we would like one person to please come to the lectern to give us the information that you would like us to take under advisement. If there are multiple people in opposition, I appreciate that you are here and you would like to have your say. But again, if what you have to bring to us has already been brought to us, please don't tie us up. Please let us proceed. Please give us the information as best you can in its entirety so we don't have rebuttals and then re-rebuttals back and forth. Once we have heard from both sides, it is the normal policy for the board to render a decision here today. However, if the board feels like information is lacking or parties need to talk or for whatever reason, it is in the bylaws that we can postpone until the next regularly scheduled meeting. Okay, at this point, the first case we'll call is Lowndes County case, VAR 2015-12, Eugene Stone, Clay Road and Old Statenville Road. Carmella, it is your turn.
Good afternoon, everyone. Our first case today is a variance request by Mr. Eugene Stone. Such property is located on the east side of Clay Road, the portion of Clay Road that runs between Old Statenville Road and Howell Road. In this case, the applicant purchased the property several years ago and is currently undergoing the plan review process for the establishment of a cemetery. When the applicant purchased the property, there were two existing buildings on the property for which we could not find any permits on. So it was hard for our staff to grandfather in the existing buildings. But the building is highlighted in green. Do not meet our setback requirements, particularly the side yard. Side yard requirement is 20 feet and the building sets 15 feet from the property line. And it wasn't enough for us to do an administrative waiver. It's just one foot shy of that. Staff looked at this case, didn't see where the building would cause a detriment or have an adverse effect on neighboring properties. The building sat far enough from the side property line not to present any. So with that, TRC has recommended approval to the variance request with no conditions.
Okay. Any questions, any discussions from the board at this time? The fact that you could not find building permits has no bearing on this. He doesn't have to retrospectively go back and try to apply for a building permit?
No, sir. At this time, as part of his plan review, yes, he would have to permit those buildings.
Has he agreed to that if the board accepts the, or grants the variance?
I feel he won't have any problem. He's here.
Okay.
He plans to use the building as a maintenance shed.
Any questions from the board at this time?
On the smaller building, he's proposing to either remove it or relocate it within one of those two. If he decides to relocate it, will he have to come to you to make sure that he meets the minimum setbacks?
And the difficulty of the large building is on a masonry foundation.
Any other questions? Any other discussion?
What type of vegetation are we considering on those three sides?
Actually, outside of this particular request, he would have to provide for a landscape buffer, and that was my calculation of what he has to do, but it's outside of his variance request. He will do that.
Any other questions? Any other discussion? Is the applicant here? Thank you, Lamella. Is the applicant here, or is there someone here representing the applicant that would like to give us additional information?
I'm here.
Okay. Would you like to give us any additional information? Are you satisfied with what we've heard?
Pretty well satisfied.
All right, sir. Please let the record show that applicant was in. Was present here and did not wish to speak at this time. Is there anyone here in opposition to this request? Is there anyone here has a question about what is being requested? Was there any contact to your office?
No, sir.
Any other questions, discussions from the board at this time?
I have one more question for Carmella. If it had been 4 feet, you could have done it administratively.
And as a continuance of that, based on the information in the report, had 4 foot been adequate, you would have done it administratively and we would not have heard it.
Yes, sir.
Okay, any other questions, any other discussions? Can we get a motion on the floor, please?
I make a motion that we grant the variance as presented by staff, citing D.
I have motion.
Second.
From Ms. Quarterman to grant request as presented, citing criteria D. I have second from Dr. Housel. All in favor, please raise your hand. Unanimous. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Good luck with it. Make it nice.
I will. Boy, that ground be out there.
Okay. Next case. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, the next case that we're calling is the City of Valdosta case, application 2015-04, Charles Bennett, 2891 Greenbelt Drive. Before we proceed with this, the board, as you've seen on the table, you have a request by Mr. Bennett's lawyer that we table this until the next regularly scheduled meeting. It is within our bylaws to grant it. It is within our bylaws to hear it today if there is someone here representing the applicant or if the applicant is here. We have a large crowd. I think most of them are here for this particular case. Any discussion the board want to talk about in a minute before we start hearing the case? concerning whether we're going to table it or whether we want to proceed without his attorney.
Trustee, how long did we know that he was not going to be here today?
I received a phone call from Mr. Lowndes' attorney, Mr. Quarterman, about 10 o'clock this morning. And we got the letter a little bit before the letter.
We have done it both ways in the past. There's no precedent set one way or the other.
Can we hear and then decide if we want to table making a decision?
That is not a problem. We have done that in the past, heard the case, pretty much got down to the end, and then decided to postpone for lack of additional information or at the request. What is your pleasure? Okay.
This request is from Mr. Charles Bennett for a variance to the front yard setbacks. His parcel is located at 2891 Green Meadow Drive, and the property has a single family residence. It's a single family residential R15, and the applicant is requesting a front yard setback variance for a carport, an attached carport that's already been constructed. And to give you a little bit of background, the applicant came in January of this year to apply for a permit to put his carport on the front of the building. Well, we gave him a zoning approval letter, solving the setbacks. Now, at the time, the front yard setbacks were 35 feet. Keep in mind that was the setback he was given at the time, in January of this year. He proceeds to build what the front porch addition or the carport was going to be. He started building an 11 by 34 attached carport, turned into a 30 by 34 carport. Upon inspection, we realized that there was some other work that had been done. A $10,000 job turned into about a $100,000 job. Right now, what we're here for is to consider a front yard setback variance. We talked about how the setbacks were originally 35 feet. There was an amendment in April or May that changed it from 35 feet to 30 feet. So if he were to pull that permit today, he'd be under the 30 feet setback. So that's what we're considering the variance right today. To show you what we're looking at, there's a single family residence, there's a site plan, you can see the portion of the carport, or the front porch that extends over the regular setbacks. You can see different angles of what has already been built. That is the distance from the curb to the front porch. About 17 feet, instead of the 30 feet required. Adjacent properties, also single family residences. Some of the additional work that has been done is adding an accessory dwelling unit. Now that is a separate board hearing from what's in front of you now. But the Board of Appeals is just to hear the variance request for the front setback. City Council would hear the conditional use permit request for the accessory dwelling structure. So two separate board processes. Zoning Board of Appeals is here just to look at the front yard setback variance request. Just to keep that in mind. There's about a 12-foot encroachment into the setback. Staff looked at it. There is no hardship. No topographical issues, nothing that would justify staff recommending or supporting a variance request. Staff recommends for denial. Any questions?
I have a question. How far, and maybe you don't know the answer, how far is the front of the house from the street?
From the middle of the street or from the street?
From the property line.
From the property line, the setback.
That's the setback.
Without easement, if he needs to be 30 feet.
From the main house to the property line.
So if he...
It's about 55 feet.
Thank you.
Okay, before we jump in wholeheartedly here, let me reiterate. We understand that there was more work done than the original application for permit was quoted for, but that is not something that this board can address. We can only address the covered awning that is over the driveway. That's the only thing we can discuss today. My first question, and just for the record, the concrete drive and any landscaping that was done, the retaining walls and all that, it can actually be in the setback.
Yes, sir.
It's the physical building itself, the roof line of the building that is in error right now, that it is extending too far out. The existing width of it is not going to be a problem except where it is in the setback.
Yes, sir.
So, when you start deliberating this, if we get to that point, that can stay there if the board sees, you know, to let that stay. That's not an encroachment. Okay, any questions from the board at this time concerning the size or the how much he's got come off or anything else? Or potentially have to come off if the variance is not granted.
Mr. Chairman, I don't have a question, but I have a question as far as if our decision today, we went ahead and decided on this matter today. If he does not have a representative here because he has requested this, will this open him to be able to come back and appeal any decision that we may make today?
First off, let me answer that. Regardless of what we decide today, if it is in fact decided to not allow it and to tell him he's got to take it off back to the setback
right.
line.
Right.
If he decides he does not wish to do that, his option is to file suit in Superior Court. And the contention would be that we erred in our decision.
Right.
And just prior to sort of address your concerns as well, Mr. Plum was the one who dropped off the letter this morning. I did make him aware that the board may decide to table it, they may not. It's at your discretion, so please aware of that.
So,
once it has been decided here, then he either has to do whatever this board granted him or told him he had to do to get in compliance, or he has to file suit.
So it would not have to come back to us.
Right.
I just want to make sure that we don't, if we make a decision today, if we don't have to rehash this out in a month or two, if he has the right to come back and appeal.
The way it reads is he cannot come back with the same request for
six months?
6 months
or a year.
It's 1 year. I know at one point it was a year on both city and county, but I thought there was a change. But if it is denied, then he cannot come back with basically the same request for 12 months. And it's never been ironclad put in the minutes of what a change in the request entails, but the rule of thumb has always been if it's a cow, don't paint it a different color and come back and try to convince us it's not a cow.
Right.
If it is a significant, noticeable percentage change in what they are asking for, then it is not the same request. But it's got to be enough that it is definitely a different request.
Okay.
Any other questions, any other discussions? Is the applicant here? Yes, sir.
I'm here on behalf of the applicant.
Jimmy? Is that, I can't see, is that you?
Yeah, that's me.
Please come to the lectern for a second, please. Most of us know who you are. Please tell us and give us your address for the record.
All right, my name is Jimmy Cone. My address is 1806 Plummer Street, Valdosta, Georgia. I was unaware that the meeting had been canceled, or this, the request had been made, and I called Mr. Bennett and Jimmy, and they both were under the impression that this was not going to be heard today. So I've sent word to them, but I don't know if they'll make it or not. So they have hired me as an architect to help them with some of the technical aspects of it.
The drawings.
The drawings and that kind of stuff. Yeah. Not necessarily to make a presentation, because Rob Plum is going to do that. So I have some information I'll be glad to share with y'all.
Okay. Do you think one or both of them may be en route, or do you think they are not coming? Or do you have a feeling for it?
I sent them a text. I'd really like to have a chance to go call them and say, you know, this thing's moving forward with or without you.
Okay. If the board has no problem with it, I'm going to set this aside until we hear the next case. And then if neither one of them are here by that point, then we can decide what we're going to do with this case. Everybody all right with that? Then you can get out a seat and touch base with them and see if you think they're actually coming. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, next case is City Case Application 2015-05, Todd Buckner, 1510 Norman Drive.
This is one of the more unusual cases that I think I've seen in some years of working with some board members. This is a case from Mr. Todd Buckner on behalf of Google Car Wash that is being built at 1510 Norman Drive in the Highway Commercial Zoning District. Currently, it is under construction. It used to be a wooden lot. It is under construction with the Union Car Wash. Basically, you can drive through similar to, you can drive through, or you can pull over and vacuum out your car, things of that nature, under development. What they are requesting a variance for is a flag. Flags are allowed with no permit under certain regulations. They can't be any bigger than 60 square feet. They can't be any taller than the tallest structure, the maximum height in that particular zoning district, 440 feet, whichever commercial. Since highway commercial doesn't have a maximum height, in this instance, the maximum height would be 40 feet. Google is not proposing to construct a flagpole that is taller than 40 feet. What they are proposing, instead of a 60 square foot flag that can be placed by right, they are proposing 150 square feet flag. They are also proposing a hoist side of 10 feet. In this instance, the hoist side would be permitted to be no bigger and longer than 8 feet. So two variances, one for size, 150 square feet versus 60, and the hoist size of 10 feet rather than 8. So those are the two variances. They did mention that High Tower Creek was nearby the property, which it does, and there's some vegetation, there's some trees, and there's some wetlands on the property as well. However, a substantial portion of the property is affected by the wetlands, by the creek, by the vegetation. So they have plenty of room. The staff's point to place the flag with it being visible and not being 100 feet square feet. The staff reviewed it, did not find the hardship, recommends to deny. However, if staff considers permitting this variance, granting the variance, They are allowed by right to have three flags under the same conditions, no taller than 40 feet, no larger than 60 square feet in size. If zoning board of appeals is amenable to granting the variance, the staff would like to limit the flags to one flag on the lot rather than three. Any questions?
I have a question about the square footage.
Yes.
The three flags are 60 square feet total or 60 square feet each?
Sorry, I didn't make that clear. Thank you.
So what you're saying is staff has requested that if we approve the 150 square foot, then that'd be the only flag?
Yes.
Do we know how big the existing one is that's there now?
On Ruben? I don't believe there is a flag.
There is.
Okay. It was not there when I come on here.
I can ask you a question in a second. I did not see a flag on how it was there either, but maybe I missed one.
I didn't see one today at all.
There's one today. Is there 12?
12.
Okay. Any other questions, any other discussions? And just for the record, when we're talking flags here, we're talking flags, state of Texas, United States flag, something like that. We're not talking about advertising banners or any of that kind of stuff. And the request by staff that should the board grant some size sign, flag other than what is allowed per the flag, that those are not being thrown out. They can still put them.
Staff would like to have, if zoning board of appeals granted the variance, staff would like it just to be just for one flag rather than three flags.
No, what I'm saying is if the board, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
I'm sorry.
What I was driving at is if the board deems it is okay to have one flag pole with one oversized flag, that does not prevent them from having other advertising flags on the ground. We just cannot have a state of Georgia flag or the Lowndes County flag or.
They would have to get permits for the advertisement.
Correct. They would have to get that in order to put those up.
Yes, sir.
That's not covered in what we're talking about.
Correct. I'm on the same page.
Okay, just for a little bit more clarification on that, what flags are we covering? What can be?
You're covering governmental flags.
Oh, wait.
Yes, ma'am. Advertising flags. Sorry.
Matt, you want to add something?
A flag on flag pole.
Flag on flag pole, government banner of some kind.
Right, as opposed to a banner on a city that's actually created, or banners that are on buildings, there's a difference between a flag and a banner.
Okay, did that answer your question?
And Tracy, along that note, the three that are allowed currently, is that the three flags that we're talking about, state, Lowndes County, and United States?
The governmental flag.
But that's what's covered under the three at 60 feet?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you.
Any questions, any discussions? Is there anyone here on behalf of Mr. Buckner or Mr. Buckner representing? Yes, sir. Would you like to give us any additional information?
Yeah.
Get your name and address for the record, please.
Mike Cooper, 105 West Central Avenue. Gugu Corporation's here on the bottom, American flag, all of their franchises. It's here on 10 by 15. And the 50 miles since it's last been in total, and three flags there. The only process available to seek that relief is through the variance process. So that's what we do.
And if the board should grant one single flag pole with the flag like you're talking about or something close to that, and it does away with the other two potential flag poles, does Gugu have a problem with that?
No, it is just the one.
Okay. Any other questions? Any other discussions?
Do you know how large that flag is that's currently?
I believe it's it's this way.
There's a Google franchise in Douglas, right?
Yeah.
Is there a flag there as well?
There is. I don't know. We didn't do the engineering on that one, so I'm not sure of the size. But we're doing one in Lake City. It's similar. It's a little bit larger than
the reason for the flag is they're trying to entice people to come in with it, therefore they want it seen from the interstate or something?
It's, they're just the American corporation that have always done it since inception.
Well, that flag, that's why I put it, pushing the height of the pole.
It's a 40-foot high pole, that's what's out there now. So it'd be the same height. In my way, it's a quarter of the pole, so it would be a portion. Yes, sir.
You'll have 30 feet from the ground to the bottom of the flag, 40 to the top. It will not be more flag than poles. It will not be more pole than flag. At one point, there were a couple of oversized flags in town. I think we're down to one maybe now, or two. Do you remember, Matt?
I am not sure. I'm trying to think of where some of the big ones were.
Pecan Place at the overpass used to have a big flag, but I think that one's gone. But McAdoo's or Zacadoo's or whatever, I think they have one on each of their places, except downtown. Is that the only two big ones that I can think of?
All I can think of them, but I think South of the Commons facility in downtown definitely a very high elevation. I don't know how large that one is, but it's probably larger than it looks from the ground.
It's a larger flag. They came before us many, many years ago to get that. Okay, any other questions, any other discussions from the board at this time? Anything else you would like to add?
No, that's it.
Is there anyone else here in support of this application? Is there anyone here in opposition to this request, or is there anyone here that has questions or needs clarification about what's being asked? Okay, so the board has pretty much broad powers. You can put whatever size flag around what they're requesting. You can scale it back. It's entirely up to the board members as to what they may rent or may not rent at all. Any questions, any discussions? Anybody willing to give us a motion to start? Motion on the floor from Ms. Lowndes. To grant the request as presented, 40-foot height, 150-foot flag size, 10-foot per staff recommendation, with the limit one single flag pole and no additional flag poles. Do I have a second? I have a second from Ms. Hobby. All in favor, raise a hand. All opposed? Okay, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 4, 1 against. It passed. Please make it look good for us, sir. Okay. Now, we will back up and go back to Mr. Bennett. Jimmy?
Okay.
Did you get in touch with him?
Yes, sir. They're here.
Mr. Bennett, would you like to address the board, give us any information? information.
Jimmy's going to speak for me, sir.
No, sir. Okay. Before we get into that, we have before you the letter requesting that it be tabled. I don't know what tabling it would accomplish, but it's up to the board to decide. I think first, are we going to table it? And if we don't table it, then it's time to act on it.
I still think that we can hear it and decide if we want to table it after we've heard.
Okay, we've heard from staff. We pretty much heard from Mr. Cone that there really wasn't anything else to add, pretty much. Is there anyone here in opposition? Apparently so. I need one person. Please come to the lectern and give us the information that you want us to take under advisement.
Okay, I'm Charlie Centerboy, and I'm a property owner in the Eager subdivision, and most all of these people here are also property owners.
Records. Can I have your address for the record as well?
Yes, it's 3116 Northfield Road.
And please let the record show that there is a large crowd.
I know you have some pictures up there, but if you don't mind, I'd like to pass ours out.
You're welcome to pass them around, sir.
These are before pictures. These are after pictures, if you can look at them. Sorry, I don't have one for everybody. The neighborhood first became aware of this project when people came out and cut down some very, very large and established oak trees on this property. Pretty much wiped out all the trees on the property. Everybody in the neighborhood was concerned. There was a lot of discussion about it. In fact, it ended up in the Valdosta Daily, a nice size article that was very much opposed to what it had done. Of course, over a period of time, that has settled down. You don't hear much talk about that anymore. But we watched over several months various types of construction going on concerning the carport. First of all, after witnessing all this construction, we went down to the city and obtained a copy of the building permit, which was described earlier. We did that through open records. The building permit was issued on the 9th of January for $10,000 to attach an 11x34 carport. And as you mentioned earlier, that carport turned into a 34. Doubled in size. Several truckloads of dirt were brought in and built up the grade significantly in front of the house. And then they put in a huge circular driveway on that raised grade. The driveway also served as a foundation for the outer part of the carport. Now construction is proceeded on. There's a lot of landscaping and stuff done in front, as you mentioned, that can be done on the setback. But now if you look at that first picture that I handed out there, you see the finished product of the carport. It appears to be totally complete. And it doesn't resemble anything. It's not in harmony at any point with the rest of the neighborhood. And you can see what the house looked like before any of this was started. So, to us, that first picture that I passed out there looks more like a commercial application. It doesn't look like a residence historically. It's huge, it's overpowering, it's over the top. And we're just not happy with it. We don't feel like it's appropriate for the neighborhood. So, we're wanting to deny the request for the variance. Now, I know you want to only talk about this variance, but while that carport was being erected, there was other projects going on at the same time.
Yes, sir. We are aware of that, and like I stated earlier, that is something that does not fall under this board. The only thing that we can talk about is the actual
But I would just like to say a few things for the picture, so we can see the picture of the project. And that is that many, many variances occurred in there because when we obtained the building permit, We also found out that there had been no inspections on the job.
Well, those, here again, sir.
Okay, but just let it...
There are no variances granted for those either. That's still to be determined by city council and engineering and construction department on that. That's, we understand that it happened, we understand it's already in, but that's not something that this board can deal with.
So somehow this carport is a separate project here?
The only part that encroached into the setback was this roof line. And the only power this board, the only jurisdiction this board has is over that part. The fact that they did other work inside and outside, that they did extensive remodeling inside and all that, and was not theoretically, at least according to the statement we have, was not inspected. All of that has either been notified and they have dealt with it, or they are dealing with it, according to staff and city council. Will have to weigh in on the additional residential structure that is there now. That's something we cannot do anything about. That's not in the area that we are able to do.
Okay, I just want to say then that with the exception of the $10,000 building permit that was taken out, which was totally did not cover the scope of that project, totally. And in fact, you said it cost more like $100,000. That's probably more than that. Throughout the entire project, and the building permit states right on there, if you're going to have electrical work, plumbing work, concrete work, mechanical work, air conditioning, so on and so forth, sprinkler systems, each one of those have to have a separate building permit. States right on the building permit.
Yes, sir.
None of those have.
Yes,
this
sir.
Whole project was attempted to be done without any oversight, anything connected with regulations and zoning and building regulations is set by the city throughout the whole project.
We understand that situation.
And now I understand resolving those others, but it's a picture. It's a picture of what they did from beginning to end.
Yes, sir. I understand what you're saying.
Okay.
Any questions from the board at this time? Is there anyone else here in opposition that would like to give us additional information that we have not already heard? Yes, sir. Please come to the lectern. You need your name and address for the record.
Certainly, yes. My name is Bernie Napier, and my address is 3 Charles Way. I have property that adjoins side and back of the property in question. And the one thing you mentioned, that many of these other things can't be considered in the realm of this piece of construction that violates the setback. But during the entire process, was there inspections that would have allowed the city to see that setback was already being violated?
There should have been inspections. I cannot speak as to why they were not there, other than the city did not know this was going on.
How could that be?
Because the permit that was pulled, the city, depended on that to be what they were doing. Now, as far as whatever inspections should have been done on that $10,000 driveway,
right,
that should have been done, but if they did not see the other stuff going on in other areas...
I'm not even speaking about the other things. I'm talking about the carport and the overhang structure and so on. So those are all subject to inspections as they proceed: framing, roofing, concrete work, the concrete preparation. All of that is within the city's purview to be looking at during that construction, because those things have to happen before you can even pour concrete, for example.
It is my assumption, right or wrong, that there were some inspections of...
But without reference to, I'm not sure if you're referring to someone back here, but those activities then are not looking at the permit that was granted?
I cannot answer that question at this time.
I know, but you're ruling out the opportunity to discuss those things, because it's not within your purview, but...
We can only talk about what is in the actual concrete on the ground and the roof line over that that is extending into the setback.
Which we certainly hope would be pulled back to the point where it's not an obtrusion into the street. Right now, the situation is if someone falls off the carport there, they'll end up in the street.
That is a possibility that this board is or will
consider. Then how do we, all of us that have come here today in order to try to, voice our situation on this and, anything that changes the way the setback is and zoning regulations, it affects all of us.
Yes, sir.
All right.
And
board, the thing I'm concerned about is that is the process with the city's inspections and so on, is that not within our opportunity to participate in?
You can question, I guess, city department.
Will they be having a hearing like this in order to try to give us an opportunity to ask those questions?
Probably not, sir, because we're going to be determining it probably here today unless it's postponed.
Well, hopefully not postponed because there's a lot of people that can't do.
I understand that there's a lot of people
In the same way, there seems to be a disregard for what construction has occurred, there seems to be a disregard for the fact that the meeting was supposed to occur and, no one was going to show up.
Yes, sir. I understand. There's a lot of people here in opposition.
But anyway,
a lot of people,
Okay.
You keep cutting me off and I'm trying to let you have your speech. I understand a lot of people are here. They rearranged schedules to be here. It is not our intent to step on toes. What we have is what we have, and we are trying, this board will be trying to determine something to try to alleviate it as best we can or whatever the board chooses to see fit.
The one point,
I think what he's trying to ask, and I don't want to put words in your mouth.
Please help.
But I think he's trying to ask, what's the permit pulled for the portico? Why wasn't there a follow-up since it was on the books that he had got the permit? Why wasn't there an inspection done periodically to make sure the portico was being constructed properly?
Okay. I'm the director of the Building Inspections Department. I'll be glad to answer that question for you. It'll give me a chance.
Okay. Name and address for the record.
My name is Mike Martin. I work for the City of Valdosta. I'm the director of the Community Development Department.
Thank you, Mike. Give us the information.
Okay. A permit was pulled to do an addition for a $10,000 addition for a porch. The inspections department only goes out and does inspections. Once we issue the permit, it is the contractor's responsibility then to call for subsequent inspections as they are required. If the contractor doesn't call, we don't go back and look to see if they have called for inspections or whatever on a periodic basis. And the only time that we found out that this was going on was when we got a call from someone in the neighborhood that we needed to go by and check to see what was going on. But there was more to it than we had assumed. But we don't just go out and do inspections on a weekly basis just because somebody buys a permit. It's the contractor's responsibility to call us for those inspections. And if we don't get the call, we don't go out there and do it. Now, if we go by a place and see something going on and we recognize that there's more there than should be, we will stop and investigate it. But we had no reason to be in that neighborhood unless we had been called. As soon as we got the call, we responded. Unfortunately, it was too late. He already had all of this built. But that's why no inspections were done prior to that porch already being on the ground.
Hold on. We're still dealing with him.
Okay.
What is the obligation? I mean, what are the consequences if the contractors don't call? Is it the honor system that they're just supposed to call?
It is. What would happen in a situation like this is that, unfortunately, electricity was already on the house. Normally, our ace is the electricity. When we get called
for someone to turn their power on. We recognize that something has been going on, so we can go back and check our records to see if all the inspections have been done. If everything's in order, then of course we go out and do our inspections, and then we can turn the power on. In a case like this, the power is already there. The electricians are just working with it and around it. And it's really, there's really not anything that can be done unless we happen to find out about the addition or remodeling or whatever that's going on. If we find out about it through curious neighbors, a phone call, through any means that we might have, then we would go out and do an investigation. We would send a city marshal out, or we would send an inspector out to do an investigation. And if we find something going on that's not permitted, then we take proper actions to make sure that that stopped. We would generally issue a stop work order. We would send a marshal out to start a case. We would require that person to come in and buy the proper permits. And then to mitigate the inspections that have not been done by whatever means we desire necessary. Now, sometimes we may can tear out parts of the wall. There's many different kinds of remedies for that. And we would require that to get us caught up to where that situation is at the present day. And once we're satisfied that the work that has been done is in accordance with the codes, and that all of the permits have been bought and penalties have been paid, then we would move forward from that point.
Do your licensed contractors generally in Valdosta understand that they are supposed to call for periodic inspections?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Do we have a licensed inspector? Do we have a licensed contractor on this job? Do we have a licensed contractor pull this permit?
No, the homeowner pulled this permit, and that is perfectly legal and allowed by state law. If a homeowner lives in the home or buys a piece of property and desires to build his own home, the state of Georgia will allow that homeowner to purchase their own permits and to do the work. If that homeowner then needs to or desires to hire subcontractors to work with him, those contractors would have to be licensed, i.e. the electrical, the plumbing, the heating and air contractors, anybody like that would have to be licensed by the state. Okay, any other questions?
Mr. Brinkman, those assets, would those subcontractors that are working, would they be obligated to participate in the permission?
Can you deal with just a minute? Let us finish with one piece.
I apologize again.
Okay. The last thing that I want to get out is the permit was pulled first part of January.
Right.
And it was only until April, May, June before they started turning dirt. So there's no reason for the city to be inspecting or even looking for that again until somebody calls and says, we're ready for you to come inspect. So it creates a tremendous burden on the city if they try to keep up with every one of them and call or send go by all the time to see what's going on. Some permits can even be pulled and never done anything with. So,
yes.
Okay, now, the other thing, if you would, please direct your comments to the board and back to him, not back and forth.
Okay, the only reason that I brought up the permitting process and the approval process and the awareness process was because I'm a homeowner, actually home builder, you know, at least a couple of situations. So I understand what Mr. Martin was talking about as far as all those steps. And I know he and the board can go out and inspect these things without someone telling them we're at a phase for completion. The only reason I brought all of that up was in order to introduce into the discussion the fact that that's just one of the elements here of all the rest that we're discussing about the parking that has been put there, doubled in size, major expansion of, not by like double the cost, but factor of 10, you know, from the original approval. And that was the point for bringing that up.
I understand. I think the board understands totally.
say something else.
Okay, very quickly.
Okay. What they just got through talking about is exactly why I said we don't need to just look at the setback. I understand that's your charge, but do you realize how many building permits were not taken out?
Sir, please.
That's not our, we can't do anything about it.
We understand that. It's in the back of our mind.
Okay, so a lot of it's...
We know all of this has gone on, but we cannot address anything on this project except the roof line that is into the setback in violation.
What about the subdivision driveways?
That's what I was saying early on. You can put a driveway in the setback as long as it is concrete and not covered. You can put landscaping, you can put retaining walls and whatnot into the setback, and it does not violate the setback. It's when you have a roof line that is attached or not attached to the house. When that extends over or into the setback, we have a violation, and that's what this board has got to deal with today.
Well, there's a safety concern to a great extent. Whether you want to hear it or not, it's part of the driveway.
It is part of the driveway. Right now, the only thing that has been advertised for this hearing today is the building setback into the, the building exceeding the setbacks. And that's theoretically, by law, the only thing that we are supposed to deal with today. If there is a safety issue with the driveway, then that's going to be something that would have to be taken up to code enforcement or traffic or whatever at that point. I understand what you're saying. I think the board agrees with what you're saying as far as it's bad to have a blind drive on a curb, but it happens in this case and it happens in other places. You just have to deal with it either through the city codes or signs or something, put a sign up for blind drive or something. But that would be something that the city engineering or building people would deal with, not us. It's not within our power, it's not within our fault.
So then, would everybody in here from the neighborhood that's opposed to granting this variance just stand up at this time?
Okay. Thank you very much.
We're
stretching this out. We need to proceed. I need your name and address for the record.
Laura Wood, 3004 Landover Road. I think that the issue regarding all the permits and everything and why it's so important to all of these people that you understand them goes to the issue of your understanding that this was not a mistake. This was not done accidentally. This was done intentionally and use that information in making your decision. I think that's what all of these folks that don't talk for a living like I do.
It is out in the open now. Everybody sees what's going on, including the city council.
Yes, sir.
City staff. It's all out in the open. We understand.
I think that's just what I wanted to let y'all understand why that those things appear to be so important to him. And I appreciate your attention.
Thank you. Okay. I have one question for Jimmy.
Thank
you. Or Mr. Bennett. Based on the information or lack of it at this point, Mr. Bennett was his own contractor. He hired everybody, and he ran the show. Yes, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so.
I need to get him on
there. Jimmy, would you like to add anything to this?
Sure.
No, Jimmy Bennett. Mr. Charles Bennett, would you like to add anything to this?
I really wasn't prepared for a conversation or to speak. Our attorney, Rob Plum, just told us this morning that this was postponed, that he wouldn't be able to make it today, and he made it clear with everybody, but I guess it was a lack of communication somewhere. Rob was supposed to speak on our behalf this morning.
Well, the problem is we got notification of this morning, like at 10:30, and officially delivered at 11 or so.
Yes, sir.
This has been known. It was going on for at least 30 days. It's been advertised for 30 days.
Yes, sir.
Rob should have known as soon as he looked at the dates, hey, we got a problem. Yeah. At the 11th hour, 11th and a half hour, he comes running in and says, hey, we want to postpone. We've got all these people that rearranged their schedules to be here, to be a part of it, to hear it.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Okay. Okay. Go ahead, Gretchen, before we try to move on and do something with this case.
If I understand correctly, Tracy, if they had proposed to build this portico ahead, and it wasn't already built, we were hearing this case on its own merits, we want to do this thing, we want to have a giant thing in the front of our house and build up the front yard and do this thing, and we need 12 feet of variance in order to do it because we can only make a 25 foot wide one and we want to make a 37 foot one. Did I get that right? They could make 25 feet by right and still be in the side. But they could come and say, then we would be deciding on the merits of, does there something about the lot or within all of the questions that we usually answer to say, should this variance be granted?
The same questions apply now. Is there hardship? Is there hardship enough to justify granting this request?
How can the same thing apply now when it's already built?
It's the same rule that we have to operate.
It's already done.
Now, sir, if you'll come to the lectern, give me your name and address for the record. What we have is what we've got. The rules don't change because it's already on the ground. We still have the same rule. If you have a problem with that, then it's got to go to city council. Because that's the way the city council has this set up. A lot of cases, they come in, they ask forgiveness instead of permission.
Yes, what we're asking for is forgiveness.
It's the way it happens. It shouldn't happen, but it does happen. It's the city council makes the rules, and we have to operate within those rules as best we can. Matt, did you have something you want to bring up?
Mr. Chairman, I was just going to try and clear up a little confusion on the question. You have before you a variance request that has been reviewed and to be reviewed under the variance review criteria as if this structure had not been built yet.
Correct.
The structure that's currently there is in violation of city code, in violation of permits. All of those trigger different processes. All of those are being dealt with. So just like we stated in your staff report, treat this as if this were new construction. This is a proposed structure. The fact that it is there illegally in violation of various things does not grandfather it in at all. So
yes.
The variance criteria are in your packet. A copy of the permit is in your packet. And I encourage you to follow the criteria.
Okay. Sir, very fast because we're running out of time. And we're.
I just heard a statement about the hardship. I'd just like to make one comment. The hardship was totally self-imposed. Yeah. The neighborhood had nothing to do.
Sir, I understand. Okay. Now, before we start entertaining a motion on the actual variance, do we want to entertain any kind of motion for a postponing per their request, or does the board want to move forward with it here and now? Okay, well, consensus of the board is to move forward with it. Okay, is there any other questions, any other discussions we need to discuss about this? The board has within its scope of powers to grant whatever the board deems fair. The board has the power to say, take it back to the limit of the 30-foot setback, which is actually 5 feet more than what he should have gotten or would have gotten had he begun building prior to city council amending that setback. So what is being asked now is based on the 30-foot setback, not the 35. Any other questions or discussions before I...
I'd just like to make a statement concerning that even though this individual might have to alter his structure 10 feet, 5 feet, 15 feet, whatever, 12 feet, you're going to still see the same image.
Well,
the same image will still be there if they can modify that structure.
But he can build to that lot line, to that setback line by right. We cannot make him take it back any further. We can prevent him from coming across it, but we cannot, within our current rules, make him go back. He got that right. So, either you're going to let him keep it, or you're going to make him tear part of it off, and you're going to make him tear it back to some level, and that level is somewhere between what he got now and 30 feet setback.
My point was, you'll still see the same image.
That's
not going to change.
Had he drawn this up and met all of the setback requirements before he drove the first nail, before he moved the first shovel, before the third, he could do exactly what he did and be within legal limits. He just would have to have stopped at the 30-foot line. And because he didn't have a licensed contractor doing it, he was not obligated. He was obligated to call for inspections, but he did not call for inspections because he did not have the proper contractor doing it. Or if he did, then the contractor dropped the ball, well, they should have. But anyway, that's beyond our scope. What we need to talk about here right now and determine is what, if anything, in the form of a variance is going to be allowed, or are you going to make him take it back to the 30-foot level? And that's the option. Any other questions? Anybody give me a motion on this request? Motion on the floor from Ms. Hobby to deny the request. Is there a second?
Second.
I have second, Mr. Paul. All in favor of the denial of the request for the variance in its entirety? That's what you intend. The denial of the request in its entirety, please raise a hand and hold it. Okay, unanimous decision for the minute, please. And before we get any further, what this means is he will have to get in touch with department staff to figure out exactly what is going to be required. But with this vote, he's got to take it back to the 30-foot setback line. He does not have to take out driveway. He can leave the concrete. He can leave the flanders and the retaining wall. But he has to remove the roof line back to that 30-foot setback or more. If he voluntarily moves it back further, then that's up to him, but he cannot cross that 30-foot line. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, that pretty much concludes the business that we've got to accomplish today. We do have a couple of minor housekeeping issues. If you want to stay and listen, you're welcome to. Otherwise, we'll give you a few minutes and we'll proceed from there. I keep telling you, in just a minute. Okay, we have other business, we have approval of amendments. Anybody got any changes, deletions, corrections? I get a motion to accept the minutes as presented. Accept the minutes. Any new business, the old business, anything to talk about?
I think it would be a good idea, but I want to start right first. We should have some type of credential at war, get a badge, authorizing us to do what we are, do what we're doing, so that we won't be questioned by some people who think we might be stalking them or their neighborhood. And if someone comes up to me and says, what are you doing here? I need two flashes of badge, but I'm part of the zoning administration, group here, and we're here to look at a site. So I'm talking about having some security when we make our site visits that will protect us. Because you just never know how people respond to you passing by there. I'm twice.
Three times.
Something you can have in your wallet, you can flip and show them who you are. Because sometimes word of mouth is not enough, and they don't trust what you're saying. Because it's suspicious as it is, and we're doing this just to protect us, and that's what I'm going to question.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let me do this then. Okay. Would y'all please look into what we might can do in some kind of ID or something?
Business card.
What you need is a badge.
A badge with a photo on it. Yeah. For example, yesterday I had to go through the U.S. Marshal's office in federal court, and they issue all lawyers pictures, badges by the U.S. Marshal's office, so we don't have to get inspected by the Secret Service and the U.S. Marshal's going through security. All you have to do is it has your picture on it, has a seal on it, and says, you know, approved by the U.S. Federal District Court or U.S. Marshal. You see something with your ID, your picture on it, that's all you need. Now, you don't need a badge, you just need something with a picture out of it.
We'll talk with our counterparts and
the city police
or the county sheriff's office, which has equipment for that. Yeah. Maybe we can come up with something.
Yeah, sometimes when I go to somebody's property, I'm like, hope they don't have a gun. Gretchen!
Okay.
If you
would look into that, and we'll talk about it at the next meeting, maybe.
Yes.
I think his point well taken. I've never been really grilled, but there had been a time or two that I could tell when he came out the front door that, hey, I'm voting for you. I'm here with Zone Board of Peoples.
You need an ID.
And I think we honestly probably need to make that clear when people go through variances, when people actually apply, that both staff and board members.
You may see people come on your property to look at it.
So
it's not a bad idea.
We can do it from that end too.
Can I ask for clarification? I think I know this answer, but on Mr. Bennett's case, the reason that everything was decided from the 30-foot setback was because he could have turned around and requested a variance later being past the date of the change that was made. Because in my opinion, he pulled the permit in April or back in January, and it was under 35 feet. He should be taking back to 35 feet.
Apples and oranges. He obtained this permit in January under the setbacks in January, 35 feet. He had no prior knowledge. We're in sad at that time. The setbacks would be changing every 30 feet. That was a proposal that the city council made.
Right.
It was adopted by the city council. If all it did was work 5 extra feet in his favor,
but
he's still in violation.
Right.
Even the new revised setback, and by a pretty good margin.
No, I agree, but I'm saying, as your case was presented to us, it was presented based on the 30-foot, not the 35-foot.
Correct.
He was in 12 feet. So is the reason that y'all chose to use the 30-foot setback instead of the 35-foot setback because he could have came and requested that additional 5 feet because now the setbacks have been changed?
No, the work that was done in the permit in January, he was in violation of that permit. He was working way beyond.
Right.
So what he was requesting was a proposal to exceed the current setback as of this month. So we applied this month's ordinance.
Because he applied now.
Correct. So he was way beyond his original permit.
Yeah, like I said, I think that we should have taken him all the way back to his original. Because that's when he pulled the permit. That's when
You wouldn't be able to impose something on him more restrictive than current law.
Well, and that's what I'm saying. Is it because he could have turned around and filed another request based on that extra 5 feet for that 5 feet? I was wondering, that's why y'all took it.
She's saying he could have come back and not honored that 1 year wait. He could have come back with a different request because of 5 feet of difference.
No, I don't think you could have held him.
That would just been a different color count.
You could have done that as litigation for something else, but in this case, there is no something else. It's just the encroachment of 12 feet over the line.
I had a question that wasn't brought up. Did Mr. Bennett ever contact y'all's office and say, hey, we're about to pull concrete?
Nope. Nothing.
Would y'all make a note of it in some kind of log if he did call?
Yes. There have been requests for inspection. That's the process that's built into the computer system. Permits are issued. They don't expire until 6 months later. Most of that work was done in June. Then a couple weeks of the permit expired, which would have been in July.
Right.
That's when the phone call started. That's when the inspection staff went out and looked and went, oh my God, what's going on here? We checked the permit, see what's being done. Obviously, it was not the same. Stop work order was issued that day, which was July 14th.
But he still completed it, though, regardless of the stop
work. Mostly completed by
the neighbors there today.
Why did they wait so long, the neighbors, until, I mean, when they started doing the framing, why did they immediately contact the city?
Well, they probably just didn't know what was issued in January.
Didn't know what permit was.
Well, or didn't know that the scope had gone beyond.
Okay, I see.
So it wasn't until the inspectors went out with permit in hand to see the work, see the permit go. Got a problem. But most of the violation is inside the building. There's a tremendous amount of work inside in terms of remodeling to which there was no permit.
What about
inspections? Now, to bring you up today, just like I put in the staff report in the background, he has since submitted all the architectural plans, gone through the permitting process, paid the double permit fees, and has made all of that right. So permits have been issued to continue the remodeling work. Initially, electrical plumbing, the carport's already there. He's still got an issue with the engineering department, but his drive and sidewalks, that's yet to be resolved. Okay. But he's got his permits now, about $100,000. But construction costs for permits. So that's underway. But pending final inspection of everything and pending the outcome of the public hearings, there will always be one of them. He has one more public hearing to go. And that's for an accessory dwelling unit inside the building, which goes to City Council and Planning Commission. So that's the next move.
How many days does he have to pull it back?
I believe it's 2 weeks under the code. But he's also got a 30-day appeal window. So there will be a communication. He either needs to remove it completely or pull it back to the point that it complies. Whatever he does to make it comply is up to him.
As long as he pulls it back to the 30-foot setback level,
or further.
If he says 30-foot is not, I'm going to pull it back something else so that it fits better or whatever. But
can you leave those columns standing there, though?
No.
So he could
there's no roof.
Right. So he could have some freestanding columns in the front yard.
Venetian villas.